Welcome to the University of Michigan Dentistry Podcast Series, promoting oral health care worldwide.
Hypertension is one of the most common precursors of cardiovascular disease, which is the leading cause of death in this country. It leads to accelerated arteriosclerosis, myocardial failure, or strokes. Elliot Richardson, former Secretary of Health Education and Welfare, recently estimated that 23 million Americans have persistent high blood pressure, and less than one-fifth are receiving effective treatment. For this reason, the dental office is an excellent place to screen for those patients with undetected hypertension. If we are truly preventive-oriented, we should consider blood pressure determination as one of our duties. It is less expensive to control hypertension than to care for those who become disabled and economically unproductive as a consequence of the disease. Prior to taking the blood pressure readings, there are certain clues that you should look for on the medical history. Persistent symptoms which may be indicative of high blood pressure include dizziness, headache, fatigue, weakness, shortness of breath, failing vision, swollen ankles, and nosebleeds. It is important to remember, however, that 90% of individuals with high blood pressure have no symptoms at all. Very little equipment is needed for blood pressure determination. A sphygmomanometer is needed, and there are two types. The first type, as you see here, is called the aneroid type, and it records its arterial reading on a dial. The second type, which is not shown here, is called the mercuroid, and it has been used in medical offices over the past 20 to 30 years. Both types include an airbag, which is used as a cuff to be wrapped around the patient's arm. Also includes a pump and an air regulating valve. A stethoscope is also necessary for blood pressure determination. The two tubes on a stethoscope are taped together, and this is to prevent any unnecessary noise of the tubes rubbing together. The ending of the stethoscope can be bell-shaped, or it can be a round, flat disc shape, as you see here. Generally, the disc is preferred because it covers a greater surface area on the arm. Now I would like to demonstrate the steps in blood pressure determination. They are cuff application, palpatory reading, systolic and diastolic determination, and the recording of the results. The patient should be seated in a relaxed position so that her elbow is on an approximate level with her heart. The arm should be extended on the armrest, slightly flexed, with the palm up. The cuff is applied to the upper arm, snugly but not too tightly, so that the lower edge of the hem should be approximately 1 inch above the antecubital fossa. This is the area right here on the inner side of the elbow. If your patient has rolled up a long sleeve, check the roll to make sure that it is not binding the arm. This might interfere with your reading. When applied properly, the cuff is snug but not tight. It is secured by these Velcro fasteners, and the label of the cuff should be approximately in the center front. With the cuff in place, you are now ready to take the preliminary palpatory reading. And the purpose of this reading is to obtain an estimate of the patient's actual systolic reading, which we will take in a moment. As the name implies, the procedure involves palpating for the radial pulse. By having the patient raise her thumb, a depression will be formed between these two tendons on the wrist. This is the area where you'll want to gently palpate for the pulse using the middle three fingers and not the thumb. When the pulse is felt with the right hand, you will want to pump up the cuff with the left hand, making sure at first that the air regulating valve is turned to the left or closed. Quickly pump up the cuff until the radial pulse is no longer felt. Then release the air at a rate of about 2 to 3 millimeters a second until the radial pulse is felt. When the pulse is felt again, this is your preliminary measurement and should be recorded. With this estimate in mind, you are now ready to proceed to the third step, or the determination of the systolic and the diastolic readings. Have your patient raise her arm in the air to decongest the arm, making several fists. With the arm back in standard position, make sure that the coils come underneath the armrest and that the patient knows that she is to keep her arm still. At this point, take a look at the earpieces of the stethoscope, which are slightly slanted. You will want them to slant away from you so that they will fit properly into the ear canal. Place the disc over the brachial artery, which is located deep and to the inside of the antecubital fossa. You may want to palpate for this artery. With the other hand, again making sure that the air regulating valve is turned all the way to the left or closed, you will want to quickly pump up the cuff again to about 20 or 30 millimeters beyond your palpatory estimate. Then again, slowly release the valve, letting the air be released by about 2 to 3 millimeters a second, and listen for the first tapping sounds. The first tapping sounds that you hear is the systolic reading, and it should be recorded. In a person with normal blood pressure, the sounds will be continuous, growing louder, then muffled, then they will fade away altogether. The point at which they fade away altogether is the diastolic reading, and it should be recorded. As I said before, the purpose of obtaining the preliminary estimate is to find out how high to pump up the cuff to hear all of the systolic sounds. In a person with normal blood pressure, these sounds will be continuous. In a person with high blood pressure, they may not be continuous. There may be a gap, and this is referred to as the auscultatory gap. Generally, blood pressure readings are classified as follows. The normal range for the systolic readings is 100 to 140. For the diastolic readings, 60 to 90. A person might be considered hypertensive if his systolic reading was 160 or above, and the diastolic reading is 95 or above. These individuals should be rescreened at another visit or referred to a physician for evaluation. The patient's age, the persistence of the high readings, and any rapid increase are all important factors in the diagnosis. These graphic diagrams will enable us to better understand exactly what diastolic and systolic blood pressure mean. The pumping action of the heart, shown here by the white lines, consists of continuous contraction and relaxation. In contraction, the blood is forced into the arteries, which expand to dissipate this force. This is the systolic phase of blood circulation, and this measurement gives us information about the force with which the blood is pushing against the artery walls during contraction. The diastolic measurement gives us information about the resistance or the strain in the vessels during relaxation. This measurement is considered more important because it indicates how much strain these vessels are under constantly. If the arteries are sclerosed, then the peripheral resistance and the diastolic pressure reading increase. Now let's transfer these principles to a simulated office situation.
Okay, Sally, I think I've finished this now. I'm not sure of the name of this drug, but it's for an allergy, but I'll call and let the receptionist know.
Okay, that'd be fine. I'll tell the receptionist to expect your call.
Okay.
Mary, the first thing I'd like to do, which is a relatively new service to our dental office, is to take your blood pressure.
Really? I've never heard of, you know, having that done before in a dental office.
Well, it's fairly new. Dr. Moore and I were talking a while back, and both of us are very aware of how many people have undetected high blood pressure, which is a serious problem. We thought the dental office would be a good place to screen for these patients.
That makes sense. I know I usually have it done when I go to the doctor.
Right. How often do you generally go to the doctor, though?
When I'm sick.
Right. I think most people are that way, and we felt that more people tend to come to the dental office on a regular basis.
I guess you probably find that most of the people with a blood pressure problem are kind of old, don't you? Do you ever find anybody with my age?
Well, generally, people are over 40 when they have a hypertensive problem, but we're not altogether safe. I don't mean to scare you. There's a form of high blood pressure called malignant hypertension. It affects people between ages 20 and 30. Okay. Now, the first thing I'd like to do is take a preliminary measurement. Would you raise your thumb, please? Okay.
This is probably really going to be high. Okay. I think I have a cavity and I'm kind of nervous.
Are you? Would you raise your hand up in the air, please? Make several fists. Okay, that gets your blood pumping through again. Okay. Actually, I take two blood pressure readings, and only one of them can be changed by being really nervous or really excited or seeing Robert Redford walk down the street. The lower reading, called the diastolic, would not be affected. Okay, get your arm out. Okay.
Was it high?
Well, it seems fine to me. I'd like to have Dr. Moore come in and say hello, though.
Oh, okay.
This presentation has shown the dental hygienist demonstrating the basic steps involved in blood pressure determination. Now that you have seen an actual demonstration, please answer the following review questions to see if the major principles are clear. Briefly describe the patient's position for blood pressure determination. The patient should be seated in a relaxed position with her elbow on an approximate level with her heart. The arm should be extended on the armrest, slightly flexed, with the palm up. Approximately where on the arm should the cuff be placed? The cuff should be placed on the upper arm, snugly but not tightly, so that the lower edge of the hem is approximately 1 inch above the antecubital fossa. Explain the easiest way to detect the radial artery pulse. By having the patient raise her thumb, a depression area will be formed between these two tendons on the wrist. By gently palpating in this depression area, the radial artery and the pulse can be felt. What is the name of this preliminary blood pressure measurement? It is called the palpatory measurement. What is the blood pressure reading called when the heart is at rest? This reading is called the diastolic measurement, and it gives us information about the strain that the heart is under constantly. What is the blood pressure reading called, which is associated with expansion of the arteries? This blood pressure reading is called the systolic determination, and the reading gives us information about the force with which the blood is pushing against the artery walls. To be placed into the ears properly, which way should the earpieces of the stethoscope be slanted? To be placed properly into the ear canal, the earpieces should be slanted away from you. Approximately where on the arm should the disc of the stethoscope be placed to detect the brachial artery? The disc of the stethoscope should be placed to the inside of the antecubital fossa area. You may want to palpate for the brachial artery in this area. What are the normal ranges for the systolic and diastolic blood pressure readings? The normal range for the systolic readings is 100 to 140, and for the diastolic readings, 60 to 90. Your patient has just run 2 blocks to make it to her appointment on time. Her diastolic reading was 95 millimeters of mercury. Is this high? Yes, this would be considered high for a person in Mary's age range. Exercise and nervousness can cause an increase in the systolic reading by as much as 30 to 40 points, but the diastolic reading should not be affected by more than a few points. Mary should be rescreened at another visit or referred to a physician for evaluation.
You've been listening to a presentation from the University of Michigan School of Dentistry, which is dedicated to supporting open learning and open educational resources. This recording is licensed under the Creative Commons. It may be reused and redistributed for nonprofit use. Please attribute materials to the University of Michigan School of Dentistry and redistribute under this same license. For more information on how this and other University of Michigan School of Dentistry recordings may be used, visit www.dent.umich.edu/license.